how vitally constructed this agency of divinity can be. Death has been present upon our planet from the very night of time itself. Forms have come and gone. Death has overtaken plants and trees, animals and the forms of human beings for untold eons. And yet our planet is not a charnel house as it well might be in the face of this fact, but is still a thing of beauty, unspoiled even by man. The processes of dying and of dissolution and the dissipation of forms goes on every moment without producing contagious contamination or the disfiguring of the surface of the earth. The results of dissolution are beneficent in effect. Ponder on this beneficent activity and on the beauty of the divine plan of death and disappearance. With man, death takes on two aspects of activity. The human soul differs from the soul in the non-human forms in that it is itself a prelude, on its own plane, an effective expression of the great divine aspect. It determines within certain limits, based on time conditions and spatial necessity, its entrance into human form and its exit therefrom. Once this exit has been made and the soul has withdrawn the thread of consciousness from the brain and its life thread from the heart, certain life processes still persist. They are now under the influence of the planetary life, however, and to these the physical elemental presumptible of the living atoms of the body nature is responsive. I would that you note the occult paradox that death is the result of living processes. Death, or the death-producing energy emanating from the planet, brings about the complete disruption of the bodily organism and its production to its essential elements, chemical and mineral, plus certain inorganic substances which are susceptible of absorption into the soil of the planet itself. Death, as the result of soul activity produces, therefore, the withdrawing from the body of the light body and of the subtle body, leaving the dense form and its component parts to the benign processes of planetary control. This soul activity produces death, as we know it from the human angle. It is necessary here to point out that this ability of the planetary logos to extract the life essence innate in each atom produces what might be called deterioration in the structure of the form at any point from whence this life essence is emitted. This brings about conditions which eventually become apparent visually, just as even the tendency to die become recognizable. Therefore, the withering of a flower, death from old age in an animal or a tree, and the many diseases of the human being are all brought about by the pull of the powerful life of the planet. Speaking esoterically, this is an aspect of what is called, erroneously, the law of gravitation. This law is, again speaking esoterically, an aspect of the law of return, which governs the relation of a unit of life and form to its emanating source. Thus thou art, unto dust thou shalt return, is a statement of occult law. In the curious evolution of words, as any good dictionary will show, the word, dust, comes from two roots, one meaning, wind, and the other, falling to pieces. The significance of both these meanings will be apparent in the sequence of ideas of the resting. With the withdrawing of the winter breath, a falling to pieces eventuates, and this is a true and significant statement. As the greater life absorbs the lesser life, the disappearance of that which the life has in form takes place. This is true of all forms in the subhuman kingdoms as they respond to the drag or pull of the planetary life. It is true also of the copyright 1999. 7, A Treatise on the Seven Rays, Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. Human form as it reacts to the call of the soul to return its life principle to the soul, via the sutrama, and to return its consciousness to its registering source. In this process and interaction, the form pulls the results of being either the receiver of the tide of life from the planet or as the releaser of that life, under Sikkhic law, to its general reservoir of living energy. Upon these two reactions depends the health or the disease of the form in various stages and states of response and under the action of other contributing and conditioning factors. There are three major stages in the life cycle of all subhuman forms, and in the human form likewise when the soul is simply an overshadowing force and not an integrated energy. 1. The stage of inflowing, a vitalization and a growth. 2. The stage of resistance, wherein the form preserves its own integrity for a temporary cycle, determined by its species and environment, thus resisting successfully any full of the all-enveloping life and any reabsorption of its vitality. 3. The stage of emission, wherein the soul of the greater life of the planet draws out and absorbs the weakening lesser life. This weakening process is a part of the Sikkhic law, as the old adage, the days of a man are 3 score years and 10, hint. When the average of a general Sikkhic period is normally run, a point of weakening in the bodily tissue will surely and gradually arise. Disease or deterioration of some part of the form usually eventuates and death supervenes. The length of the cycles and their determining cause are a deep mystery and are specifically related to the various kingdoms in nature, and to the species and types and forms within those aggregates of living processes. These cycles are known as yet only to the masters and to those initiates to whom is given the task of promoting the evolutionary process within the subhuman kingdom, and to the devas whose task it is to control the process. As you well know, the great distinction between the human kingdom and the three worlds and the other kingdoms in nature is the factor of free will. In the matter of death, this free will has, in the last analysis, a definite relation to the soul. The will of the soul is either consciously or unconsciously followed, where the decision of death is concerned, and this idea carries with it many implications which students would do well to ponder. We have arrived now at another major generalization as to disease and death in relation to humanity. Law 8. Disease and death are the result of two active sources. One is the will of the soul which says to its instrument, I draw the essence back. Higher other is the magnetic power of the planetary life which says to the life within the atomic structure, the hour of reabsorption has arrived. Return to me, thus, under Sikkhic law, do all form back. Copyright 1998 Lucas Trust. 148. A Treatise on the Seven Rays. Volume 4. Esoteric Healing. The reference here is to the normal dissolution and the form at the close of a cycle of reincarnation. As we well know, this cycle is determined in the case of man by major psychological factors which contain or prolong the hour of the end, but only up to a certain point. The dictum of the soul and the fiat of the planetary life are the final determining factors, except in the cases of war, accident, suicide or epidemic. The power of absorption with which the planet is endowed is very These epidemics have a serious effect upon the human race after the war cycle is over and after the consequent epidemic has spent itself. Humanity, particularly in Eastern Europe, had not completely recovered from the epidemic, incident to the first part of the World War, when the second part took place. The psychological effects continue. The scars and the results of the second phase of that World War will persist for 50 years, even though, owing to man's greater scientific knowledge, the epidemic factor may be kept surprisingly within bounds. This, however, still remains uncertain. Time alone will demonstrate how successful humanity is in offsetting the penalties which outraged nature is apt to exact. Much good will be brought about through the growing custom to cremate those forms which the indwelling life has vacated. When it is a universal custom, we shall see a definite minimizing of disease, leading to longevity and increased vitality. The factor of resistance is a process whereby a form renders itself immune or non-responsive to the planetary pull and urge towards reabsorption requires the expenditure of much energy. When the life increases in potency within the form and there is less reaction to disease-conveying factors, the soul within the form will have fuller sway and greater beauty of expression and usefulness in service. This will be true someday of all the humans in nature, and thus we shall have a steady radiance shining forth in the mounting glory of the light of God. 3. Racial and national diseases. It must be apparent to you by now that I am principally concerned with indicating factors which are the result of the past history of the race rather than with giving you a specific and detailed account of the diseases which are allied to the various nations. This, in fact, it would not be possible to do, owing to the overlapping and paralleling which goes on in every department of natural life. Above everything else, I seek to make clear what must be done along the line of preventive healing and what should be accomplished in the difficult task of offsetting conditions already prevalent on Earth as the result of past misuse of the natural powers. There must therefore be brought about a healing of those conditions which are present upon our planet on a large scale, and consequently my emphasis will not be upon the specific of the individual. I am laying a foundation also for a discussion of our next theme, the relation of the law of karma to disease and death and to humanity as a whole. Copyright 1998 Wolf Trust. 149. The Treatise on the Seven Rays, Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. In the consideration of racial and national diseases, I do not intend to point out that tuberculosis is distinctively a disease of the middle classes in every country, that diabetes is a major trouble among the right-eating peoples of the world, and that cancer is rampant in Great Britain, whilst heart disease is a prime cause of death in the United States. Such generalizations are both as true and as false as statistics usually are, and nothing is gained by laboring these points. Difficulties will all be offset in due time through the growth of understanding, by the intuitive diagnosis of disease, and by the magnificent work of scientific and academic medicine, plus a pure comprehension of right living.